In a 2016 pilot project, Toronto put bike lanes on a 2.5-kilometer stretch of Bloor Street West in the Annex and Koreatown. We lived in the neighborhood at the time, and the new lanes, however modest, actually played a big role in us becoming more comfortable biking in cities. We used them often to get around the neighborhood, including to the University of Toronto and Christie Pitts Park, but being so short, they were less useful for reaching other neighborhoods.
This pilot project was the subject of a study, which we've linked in the description, finding a dramatic improvement in perceptions of safe cycling on the street, especially among cyclists themselves. Economic indicators improved after the bike lanes, but that was also found for a comparison street that didn't experience any infrastructure changes, so it's hard to know if the bike lanes had a positive effect, but there also wasn't an obvious negative effect.
One interesting finding is that merchants were a lot more likely than customers to arrive on the street by car, and that merchants also tended to overestimate car use among customers. Almost half of merchants on Bloor arrived by car, compared to just 1 in 10 customers. Most visitors actually just arrived by walking, and among the different types of customers, those who arrived on foot were the most likely to spend at least $100 a month on the street.
The major weakness of these lanes, their short length, was fixed in 2020 when the pandemic accelerated Toronto's bike lane expansion plans, including an extension of this pilot to a serious bike corridor covering Bloor Street in the west and Danforth Avenue in the east. Normally, bike infrastructure in Toronto is controversial. There's a lot of rhetoric about the so-called war on cars, but this time it actually went fairly smoothly. Except for a suburban councillor who proposed scrapping the project and offering more free parking instead. But some things never change.
As a long and direct bike corridor following 15 kilometers over a subway line, it's hard not to notice the similarity with Montreal's new Saint-Denis Express bike corridor covering 11 kilometers over a metro line, which we now live near and which we praised a lot in a recent video. As we talked about in that video, being able to follow a simple and straight route matters a lot for the cycling experience. Indirect routes are a burden on people's time and mental energy, and they're a subtle but easy way to discourage people from choosing to get around by bike.
On this point, the Bloor-Danforth bikeway is actually a little more direct than its Montreal counterpart because Bloor and Danforth are two ends to the same street, so the entire 15-kilometer route can be done without turning at all. Montreal's Saint-Denis corridor is good for directness, but it's not able to quite match that simplicity because you switch streets once or twice.
Where the Bloor-Danforth lanes fall behind is consistency. Separation from car traffic on much of the corridor is top-notch, as good as Montreal or better. Especially when you're separated from traffic not by concrete or parked cars, but both of those things together. In some places, though, the separation leaves a lot to be desired, like the sections where you're in a small lane separated from fast-moving traffic by nothing but paint or the flimsiest kind of bollards. That's not actually the worst part, because we encountered a stretch underneath train tracks by the Bloor GO station that didn't have bike lanes at all, even painted.
Underpasses like that are exactly the kind of potentially low-visibility areas where separation from car traffic is extra important. This Toronto corridor probably has more concrete separation than Montreal's Saint-Denis corridor on average, which deserves praise, but Montreal's development seems to be more strategic in its placement of concrete, focusing more on dangerous places like intersections and underpasses. An underpass on Saint-Denis was actually the site of a cyclist's death in 2014, back when the street looked very different than it does today.
Comparing these two corridors for consistency and planning is a little unfair, because Saint-Denis is based on a deliberate vision for an express bike network, while Toronto's Bloor-Danforth is more of a patchwork, because it was implemented more hastily for the pandemic. Some of it's even technically considered temporary. Still, these details are important to notice.
As for parking, most segments have car parking sensibly to the left of the bike lane, similar to Saint-Denis in Montreal. But in the middle around Bay Street, we notice parking to the right of the bike lane, which seems obviously worse in so many ways. Drivers have to cross the bike lane to park. Passing parked cars on the driver's side means you're more likely to get doored, and the parked cars no longer act as a useful barrier to separate cyclists from moving cars. One good feature we noticed in the better parts of the corridor was integration of bike parking into the separation between bikes and cars. There are even some stations for Toronto's bike share system.
Despite some issues, this new corridor is a substantial improvement to Toronto's bike network that we are really happy to see. Unfortunately, when we were there, it wasn't just cyclists who were excited to use this new space. We also saw drivers who thought the bike lane was a drop-off zone, or this pedestrian who was pretty confident that the bike lane was just another extension of the sidewalk. On the bright side, on reviewing our footage after we got home, we realized that we passed CJ Hoyle, who has a Toronto-based cycling channel that we enjoy.
This Bloor-Danforth bikeway isn't the only big improvement to Toronto's bike network since we lived there just 2 years ago. Another key route we noticed was University Avenue, which has completely new bike lanes connecting Bloor to downtown, although they don't go quite as far as Google Maps would have you believe.
A recent study tried to measure the benefit to Toronto's bike network from all the improvements put in place for the pandemic. Using a system of ranking routes according to suitability for cyclists, they analyzed Toronto's bike network before and after the pandemic. Based on the second lowest tier of stress, so routes that should be suitable and comfortable for the majority of the adult population, Toronto's pandemic improvements increased the job, population, and food accessibility of its bike network by 10 to 20%. Still, these benefits were concentrated in more central parts of the city, with far less bicycle accessibility in Toronto's suburban areas.
Let us know your experiences cycling on the Bloor Danforth Bikeway in the comments. Thanks for watching, and don't forget to bike and subscribe.